This is Beyond the Ball.
What's going on? What's going on? What's going on, ballers? Welcome to another episode of Beyond the Ball. And the focus of this show is helping student athletes to succeed beyond their degree, right? And we talk about stories, strategies, and successes. So today, I'm excited to have our guest. And we're gonna learn a little bit about softball. We're gonna learn about so much more than that. But welcome to Beyond the Ball, Miss Jania Davis. Jania, how are you doing?
I am doing well. I am complete. I am blessed. I'm good.
Awesome. Awesome. So how's the weather currently in Florida right now? How's the weather?
Actually, I'm currently not in Florida. I'm in Georgia right now, and it is freezing. We had a whole week of like 13 degree weather, but I'm going back to Tallahassee very soon.
Gotcha. And I know Tallahassee is beautiful. I know Tallahassee is definitely beautiful. So you're a softball player at FAMU, right? You're entering your senior year, and you know COVID and everything like that happened. So mm-hmm. so after this year, like, are you going to be done playing softball, or you have another year, or what does that look like for you?
I do have another year of eligibility. However, it's still up in the air, you know, if I'm going to take it or not.
Okay, gotcha. So are you thinking about, what is it like making you think, like have the deciding factor of if you want to take it or not? Because I've seen like a lot of student athletes, like it seemed like everybody getting a master's, right? It seemed, and I've tried to get a master's and I was not successful getting a master's, mm-hmm. but it seems like there's more and more student athletes getting a master's. Is that just me or?
No, I know a lot of student athletes who are getting their master's. A lot of people are actually finishing their bachelor's like a year or a semester early to get their master's. But me, I do plan on getting my master's. I just don't know like what I want to do with it, actually.
Gotcha. So since you're more connected with student athletes than I am, or you have more interaction with student athletes, you know, with your teammates and everything like that. If you were to assume, why would you assume you think more are getting masters? Because it's not easy. What would your thought be there?
Well, number one, because a lot of student athletes had an extra year of eligibility because of COVID, they have mm-hmm. an extra year to play. So it's like some of the master programs are 1 year programs. So it's like, why leave that money on the table? You know, if you can basically get your degree for free while still being a student athlete for that extra year of eligibility.
Gotcha. That makes sense. That makes sense. Okay, fair enough. Okay, cool.
But,
cool.
You know, you do have, you know, people staying to get their master's, but they're not coming out of school with, you know, good enough offers when it comes to jobs. I know for, like, the business industry, a lot of the companies are starting to require master degrees. So it's just like, do I stay to get my master's or do I bet on myself with my bachelor's and, you know, have other innovative businesses on the side.
Makes sense. Rolling the dice on self. Okay. Right. Okay. Yeah. I mean, I guess that does make sense. Not, I guess that definitely makes sense. Like if you have free money on the table and there's opportunity for you to get another degree, and then this is going to put you in a better light or put you, depending on the career path, depending on the industry, right? Not mm-hmm. necessarily a better light, but just maybe increase the probability of you getting the position that you desire.
For
then,
sure.
You know, why not? So, okay.
Yeah, because, you know, us being young, we like to think of now and not the future. So it's just like, what justice would I be doing my older self for, you know, leaving money on the table like that? So it's a hard pill to swallow, but I would definitely recommend not leaving money on the table.
Yeah. I'm with you. If there's money on the table, I will gladly receive that. I gladly receive that. So Jania, I was looking and I seen you have a little bit of, JUCO in your background.
Yes. I have a lot of it.
Yeah. Talk to us about your junior college experience, because I mean, too often I wouldn't say I see the junior college story of softball players, yeah. right? And that might be to my ignorance, and that might be to, you know, like the things I might search and the lack of awareness that I have, right? Mm-hmm. So just talk a little bit about JUCO, because okay. I don't think people you know, really get that taste of what JUCO life is like?
Well, I had about 4 offers coming out of high school, and there it was some JUCOs, some universities, but I wanted to go to where the schools offered me the most money. And so I end up committing to TCC. I didn't even know about JUCO until I got the TCC. And during my process of, you know, my first two years, I realized that, like, JUCO with softball, these girls are not, like, sorry or, like, undeveloped. These girls just got recruited late. Like, JUCO has heavy competition when it comes to softball. Like, the Panhandle Conference, it's some heavy hitters in the Panhandle Conference, for sure.
Okay, I never knew that. Wow. Okay.
Yeah. And it's very, very, very exciting to watch. Like, junior college softball is nothing compared to, like, high school. It doesn't even feel like junior college. It almost feels like a university. That's how, like, tough the competition is in junior college.
Okay, so the competition is tough. Like, what about the crap? Like, is there a certain environment? Because, you know, when we talk, like, basketball, or when we talk football, you know, they're like in those type, I don't want to say, well, it is an arena in a sense, but I know typically with softball, or I haven't seen too frequently with softball, like a stadium type setup, or I don't know. Help me out, Jania.
Yeah, so with junior colleges, the stadiums are not as nice as the universities. But you do have some colleges that do have, you know, smaller stadiums for the girls to play softball. I would say the best, like, field that we actually played at was probably Gulf Coast State.
Hmm. Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay.
And that's in Panama City. So you already know they have a really nice campus and a really nice field.
Fair enough. Okay, so
softball, we take pride in the field appearance.
As you should. Yes. As you definitely should. So okay, so you grew up in Florida, or how did you end up getting the TCC out in Florida? How'd that work out?
I honestly don't know how my coach found me, because I switched travel ball teams my senior year, and I ended up playing with the Atlanta Vipers, and then one tournament, the assistant coach, Coach Abby, she came and she was like recruiting me, and she gave me her card and everything. And like, we scheduled a visit. I took a visit to Tallahassee. I'm like, I love this place, because I had visited at least 3 or 4 schools before I went to the TCC. And so I don't know how she found me, but she found me by the grace of God, because as soon as I went to Tallahassee, I was like hooked on, this feels like my second home.
So after TCC, mm-hmm. what made you go the HBCU route? Not necessarily just FAMU, but what made you go the HBCU route?
Number one is because my mom has always spoken to us how, you know, excellent people come from HBCUs. And so my mom, she graduated from Clark Atlanta. And so I had a friend in high school. She introduced me, you know, to FAMU, the FAMU culture, my senior year. Because I had no clue about FAMU until I actually graduated. And so once I started to learn more about the softball program and how it's a winning program and they focus on sisterhood and togetherness, I actually started to like it. And so during our fall season, when I was at TCC, we would scrimmage FAMU. And just like the culture that they had at the games, the energy, I'm just like, I have to be on this team. Like, I have to be on this team. So I was in contact with one of the coaches. They didn't have money for me at the time, but, you know, when time presented itself, they definitely got Jania Davis on the team.
Oh, I love it, because I've had the opportunity to, you know, go down to Southern and speak at Southern. And, you know, my family at Thanksgiving, they always do the whole Southern Grambling thing and push for HBCUs. And I never really understood the HBCU experience until I went down to Southern for the first time. And I'm like, this is different, right? It's real. And I went JUCO, and then I went to a PWI. Mm-hmm. But really, the culture of excellence that comes from HBCU, it's just like a family environment. Okay. And it's like that family member that pushes and demands greater of you because they know what you're capable of. Mm-hmm. And also like that older cousin, it's just like the whole family. Cause like, it's that older cousin that's letting you know what's coming up and why you have to be prepared and why you need to do this and do that. Mm-hmm. I didn't get that at a PWI.
Oh, I know, because I didn't get that at TCC. But when I went to FAM, it was a big culture shock. Like, I knew about adversity, but I didn't know about adversity until I got to FAMU. And it just, like, made me mentally tougher. It just prepared me. Like, it shaped me and developed me. And I didn't know what I was going through until, like, this year. I'm like, wow. I was being prepared and tested this whole time. Now, don't get me wrong. TCC was not a walk in the park mentally. It definitely prepared me too. But my HBCU, it definitely is teaching me how to face adversity and don't quit. Like, just see everything through.
Well, hold on, wait, Jania. You can't just give us that gem like that and then just move on.
Okay.
You said you thought you knew about adversity, but once you got to FAM, then you really found out. Go another layer deeper. Like, what are you talking about? Like, help us understand in terms of like adversity and what you learned at FAM thus far.
Being at FAMU, like, it teaches you about real life things before it kind of like happens. So, like, for example, say if you have an issue with like finance or like financial aid, but you have rent due in 2 days, but you're trying to figure out how you're gonna come up with the money. Instead of just like folding, like just see everything through. Like, you're gonna stress, you're gonna have, you know, mental like crazy episodes of like you don't think it's gonna happen, but in reality everything is going to happen. It just pushes you to just like see everything through. Like, don't quit, don't lose faith. Like, cause stuff like that happen in the real world. People, you know, your tire may get flat and you can't make it to work. If you can't make it to work, now you can't get no money. And then how you gonna pay for rent? So it's like everything that I'm learning at FAMU is teaching me once. It's preparing me for when I graduate. I'm already knowing.
Understood. Okay, earlier we were talking a little bit about FAMU softball. We touched on it, but I want you just to share with me a little bit more about the softball program, because, you know, people might have seen y'all's program, seeing y'all stroll, you know, viral stroll action going on.
Yes.
But just talk a little bit more about what does FAM softball have to offer? What does FAMU softball have to offer?
Number one, I would say FAMU softball teaches you to know how to be vulnerable in certain spaces, like when it comes to your sisterhood and, you know, when you are surrounded by people with a common goal, learning how to not take things personally. We implement a lot of things in our program that's bigger than us being athletes. You know, we are learning about finances, we're learning about mental health, we're learning about our consciousness and our self-awareness. You know, we're just learning about a lot of stuff on top of softball and on top of the sport and on top of our academics that we are, you know, currently learning. So the program is definitely not something that's like a for face, like people see on social media. Like, that's like the tip of the iceberg. Like, it's a whole bunch of stuff that we go through and we have to, you know, commit to in order for that, you know, for that to be seen to the public. But it's a good journey to be on, for sure.
Yeah. And I mean, one thing I've realized is that when you're a part of a team, like sometimes I think people don't understand, or they choose to not see, but when you're a part of a team, you're going through like all four seasons with these people. You seeing them when they struggling, like you were talking about earlier with rent money. You seeing when you got a friend that struggled to have something to eat. You see when you're pushing mental strengths to lift weights and to keep running when you're exhausted, and seeing people go through heartbreaks and relationships. Yes. And when you see people in those spaces, like, a lot of these situations bring forth like make or break relationships with people. right? Like these are things that help bring a team together, or, you know, can separate them. So, you know, with you sharing that, I think that's really dope to hear, especially the part about the sisterhood, because, you know, college can be lonely. Like, if you choose that, you can be on a team and still be lonely if you choose to be.
Absolutely. So, absolutely.
Don't nobody want to be out there like that, out there bad, especially like that.
Especially if we got a 40-plus game season to play. Like, who wants to be lonely during that? Mm-mm. Got to learn how to be vulnerable and just lean on somebody, because we both on the team, like, we both got to go through it. Why go through it alone?
Yeah, yeah, for sure, for sure. So after your time at FAMU is over and done with, how do you want to be remembered?
I want to be remembered as the person that wasn't afraid to be my authentic self. I just want to show up as Jania Davis and not feel like I'm being judged or anything, because at the end of the day, if you're doing something right or if you're doing something wrong, somebody's going to always have something to say. So you might as well be you.
Mm. That's real.
For sure.
Yeah, people are always going to have something to say, just as we've seen with Coach Prime. Everybody has a choice. Everybody.
It's a catch 22. It's two sides to every story. So it's just like, write your own story.
Yeah. You're right. It's a catch 22. You either lose or you lose.
Right.
Sadly, you know. I'm being funny, but. Yeah. Okay. So what has with this whole NIL thing happening, right? NIL taking over. What has NIL done for you?
Good question. So far, NIL has exposed me to a lot of networking, for sure. It has taught me, you know, if you want it, you got to go get it. You know, nobody's going to just come up to you and be like, hey, here's $10,000 for you to post me on your blah, 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 blah. Unless you probably go to like a Power Five school. But NIL has definitely taught me that, you know, if you want it, you have to go get it. And it has, you know, plugged me in with the AL Collection. So he does HBCU clothing. And so I signed a deal with him. And it's pretty cool because he does all HBCUs, you know, he don't show no favoritism, and his clothes is super dope. So if you want to shop AL Collection, the link is in my bio.
Okay. Yeah. And we'll drop it in the show notes. Yeah. We'll drop it in the show notes. So that's pretty cool. So he creates just all different type of clothing for HBCUs, like, yes, t-shirts and stuff like that.
Cardigans to fitness wear, to t-shirts, to sweatshirts, to like hockey jerseys, to like varsity jackets. Super dope.
Dang.
Yeah, super dope.
Okay. That's what's up. Okay, that's what's up. Fair enough. So now we're gonna, well, wait, before I get here, I want to ask you, did you have the opportunity to, because I've seen that they had some NIL conferences and stuff like that going on. Did you have the opportunity to tap into some of the NIL activities going on, the conferences and stuff like that?
Yeah, I actually went to the summit this past summer back in June. It was a 3-day conference, and it was really it felt like a celebrity moment, but more on like a smaller scale. Like, you had some of the top athletes in one building. We all, you know, posted up for the red carpet. We were able to, you know, network at this event. We was able to sit and listen to motivational people speak. We was able to attend, you know, financial literacy conferences. It was like one of the dopest experiences I experienced this year, for sure.
That's solid. And that was the influencer.
Yeah, that was the NIL summit.
Yeah. Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay.
That was the first one ever in history. So I'm gonna be able to tell my kids I attended the first NIL summit in history.
That is dope, though. It's always dope being the first.
Okay.
It's always dope being the first. So now we're gonna transition and. And I want you, just in this segment, this is called Dear Student Athlete, right? And this is the opportunity for you to share a nugget, a word of wisdom, some advice.
Okay.
To a current student athlete. Like if they're right in front of you, they're like, Jania, I'm a piece of clay, mold me. What would you tell them?
So I actually had wrote this this like message on my Instagram, and it was said, dear student athlete. So I'm gonna just read it to you, if that's cool.
Please.
Okay. It says, dear student athlete, I see the hard work and dedication you've been putting in all year. Trust me, the hard part is what always goes unnoticed, but it's okay. God made us special for a reason. But never forget, before an athlete, you are a student first, and before a student, you are, and before a student, you are human. You have feelings, you have mental and physical struggles, you have highs and lows, just like everyone else. The key to it all is balance. Balance is life. During your off season, take care of your mental health and physical well-being, because in a couple of months, you'll be right back at it all over again. Once upon a time, you dreamt of being right where you are. Don't give up that dream, because once it's over, it's hard to bring it back around. Do yourself some justice and appreciate everything that comes with your job, because I promise everyone's journey doesn't last forever. Keep grinding, stay balanced, and cherish every moment. Namaste.
Slow clap.
I wrote that back in, when was this? Back in May.
What was the inspiration behind it?
I had tore my hamstring twice, and I actually wasn't able to play like 90% of my season at FAMU. And this was my first year here. And so, mind you, I just did a really, really good job at TCC. I won Conference Player of the Year. I did my thing. And so when I came to FAMU, I was really trying to prove myself. And then my hamstring tore, and I'm just like, bro, I hope the girls don't think I'm just like BSing or whatnot. Like, I'm really deal hurt. And so that whole time period was kind of dark for me. And I just like kind of wanted to give up softball and walk away. But it's just like, I'm not going to do that, because, you know, what example will I be setting just to walk away once I'm already down? So I had to see it through. And you know, I was having teammates also that had, you know, mental health problems and stuff, because that's not something we, you know, embrace as a student athlete, because a lot of people don't see us as people. We are people before we're athletes. So that was my inspiration for sure.
Man, that's real.
Yeah. Yeah, I told you I keep it authentic.
Hey, I wasn't doubting you. I'm here. Yeah. I'm about to start slow clapping over here and start doing some snaps. Yeah, get the snaps going. Oh man, but that was strong. Thank you for sharing and trusting me with that. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, most definitely. So now we're about to transition into a segment I like to call this or that. Okay, so you're gonna pick one or the other, a little rapid fire, just for fun. Okay. Now, are you ready?
I am ready.
All right, here we go. Bus ride conversations or conversations with your suite mates or roommates?
Oh, conversations with my suite mates and my roommates. We had some deep conversations, some deep ones.
I can only imagine. Okay.
Yeah.
Working out with friends or hanging out with friends?
Working out with friends. If I had the option to work out with my friends and we all go to the gym, oh my gosh, that would be like a perfect day. But my friends don't wake up as early as I do, so.
Understandable. Netflix or Hulu?
Netflix.
JUCO or four-year university?
I'm gonna say JUCO, because it created a foundation in me.
That's real. Pancakes or waffles?
I'm gonna just go with waffles. I'm a picky eater. I don't do pancakes or waffles.
Oh my goodness. Are you vegan?
No, I'm not vegan, but I am trying to make a transition into like, stop eating chicken. I stopped eating beef and pork, but chicken and fish is still like right there.
I got you. Beaches or mountains?
Mountains. I love hiking.
Fair enough. Fair enough. That was it. See, that was quick. That was painless. It wasn't bad. It wasn't bad at all. Yeah, it wasn't bad at all. Wasn't bad at all. So now we're about to get ready to land this plane. And I'm just curious of who is one individual, right? You're like, this person, you can say one or more, but you're like, this person is dope. This person is killing it. I want to put the spotlight on them. And I think you should interview them next. Who is that person for you?
Ooh, student athlete wise?
You tell me. It's your person.
All right, so I have two. Okay. One would be Darcy Khan. She is a new track runner at Howard University. She just transferred from University of Kentucky. We grew up together. We did almost everything together. We both played sports, and we was good competition for each other. So shout out to her. She's doing her thing. She's loving her HBCU. So I'm proud of that. And then my second person would be Kaylin Harris. Kaylin Harris, she's a broadcast journalism major at Florida A&M. And she just released this film regarding student athlete and mental health. And she killed it. Her and her co-pilot, Kaya Kudo. I'm sorry if I butcher her name. But she killed it. So I would definitely go check her out.
That's what's up. That's what's up. You have to connect me. That's what's up. That's what's up. That's what's up. Well, you know, I appreciate you taking the time to grace us in the place with your face and your voice and your poetry that you hit us with. You know, you're getting your 4-page letter of Leon over there. We're not mad. We're not mad about it. But now, Jania, just go ahead and let people know where they can find you, follow you, and stay connected with you and all that good stuff.
Okay, well, you can follow me on Instagram, opulenceof_JaniaDavis. And you can also find me on Twitter at _JLove with 2 A's.
There it is. There it is, folks. There it is.
And I'm also on LinkedIn.
Are you on LinkedIn?
I gotta put that out there. I'm a business major, so you know, I have to network. I have to do my due.
I got you. I'm gonna connect with you on LinkedIn. Yeah, I'm gonna link it up on LinkedIn because people be sleeping on LinkedIn.
People sleep on LinkedIn. Your network is important.
Your
network is your
everything. Your network determines your net worth, and vice versa.
Okay.
So there it is. There it is. But yeah, Jania, man, thanks so much for blessing us. Like I said, and everybody out there. If you enjoyed this episode, make sure to hit subscribe. If you're watching on YouTube, I hope you did watch on YouTube. And at the same time, if you're listening on audio, you know, Apple or Spotify, be sure to leave a rating, review, and share with one student athlete that you know could benefit. All right. Because this is Beyond the Ball, where we help you succeed beyond your degree.
Bye. Thank you, Jonathan.